We're a pokemon. This is a Hmong market and also a Hmong restaurant inside. So let's go. In the Hmong culture, we wear a lot of Hmong clothes, which usually the girls would wear dresses like this, and then the guys wear vests with a lot of coins. And for this, it kind of symbolizes like everyone's kind of have money. No one is in poverty. No one's in bankruptcy, and everybody's just the same. And then for the Hmong culture, it is really traditional to wear Hmong clothes on special occasions to show a lot of respect towards the elders and the new generation that's coming up. Usually I go straight to the restaurant to go get something to eat, and other than that I come here to buy my Hmong vest. My Hmong vest.
Do you wear it on special occasions?
Yes, we wear it on special occasions.
What kind of occasions?
Like Hmong New Year's, or when we do this ceremony called Onang, or what we call the spirit bags to our body, which is in English I think it is called Jing Bell. So we ring a lot of bells as we do the occasion. You find a lot of more Asian materials and Asian recipes and like merchandises here, other than just going to a mall where you find like shoes and regular Aeropostale shirts and jackets.
So it's more typical like clothing and things that relate more to your culture.
Yeah, it'll be more around the Hmong-based religion and culture.
Have you ever been to Laos or like to Thailand?
I've never been to Laos or Thailand. I lived in the States my whole life. But I always wanted to try to visit there to know where my dad talks about all these places where he had to run, all the places he had to hide. And like, I just find it really interesting to know that we come from such a brutal background to where we could always try to visit the place where we had to start off. The Hmong community is getting bigger and bigger. And as it gets bigger, we have to get a new building so everybody can fit in. So there's new vendors and more vendors to come enjoy the kind of community we have in Milwaukee. I play a musical instrument called the pain. That's one of my favorite hobbies. For that, I find it really interesting to know that it is one of the most important instruments inside the Hmong shamanism religion.
I'm a current student at Marquette University. It's my freshman year, and I am studying criminology and law studies, and I hope to get into law school in order to become an immigration lawyer.
Okay, so basically what we have here is a mural. In this mural, you'll basically see what the Mexican-American culture is like. We have César Chávez. César Chávez is very important to us Mexicans Americans due to the fact that when the campesinos, which are basically people that used to work in the fields, when they were brought over
Mexican-American kind of gives me the best of both worlds of being American and being Mexican, and because of that I feel the necessity to sometimes just keep the Mexican culture alive by doing Aztec dancing. I've been doing it since I was 8, and I also do Mexican folk dancing, and it's just kind of relating back, because when Spaniards arrived to Mexico, they took a lot of the Aztec culture that the indigenous people had. So because of that, for me being able to do Aztec dancing is a way of keeping that culture alive, even though most of it has disappeared throughout the centuries.
Okay, so basically these are the headpieces that the Aztecs would wear. As you see here, they're very colorful. These kind of go along with the whole Aztec garment. We have the cheetah print because it was very typical for the Aztec, you would say like the priests and the people at the top of the hierarchy would wear a lot of like the prints when they would go off to war and stuff with other like different Aztec tribes. So we see the feathers here, and basically it's more of like dances from the indigenous people of Mexico, which basically Mexican people come from the Aztecs, but Mexicans are from Aztecs and the Spaniards. So this is a traditional headpiece for Aztec dancing. And this is what you would, like symbols. This is a jaguar, and this is the typical symbol for an Aztec person, Aztec man. Basically, when the Aztecs would call out to reach to their gods, they would blow in a shell. So that's basically what the shell is symbolized here. So when you start an Aztec dance, you basically will blow into the shell, and it will make a noise to call the gods over. So because we are in the south side of Milwaukee, we kind of have a mural here on, this is the UCC Center, and it stands for United Community Center, and it's also linked with Ruiz Guadalupe School, which is an elementary school and a middle school. And because we are close to Mitchell Street used to be Milwaukee's downtown area, and many of the Polish community used to live down here, so that's why we have the clock here as well. Right here we have Puerto Rican dancers. We have the Statue of Liberty. I'm guessing it's like representing the United States. And then we have two eagles. One of the eagles symbolizes the Mexican eagle. So we have the Mexican eagle on the left side, and then we have the American eagle on the right side. And then we have a Mayan statue. We have the domes for Milwaukee, and then we have an Aztec temple.
So my religion sort of shapes my way of life, but it does go along with my culture because it shapes how my culture was built. Although a lot of people in my country are Christians, it's mostly a mix of Christians, Jews, and Muslims. But the majority is Muslims, so everything that we do has to do with how we were brought up by the Quran, which is like the holy book of Muslims. Background of my country, I'm Palestinian American, and my parents were both born in Palestine. My mom was actually born in the capital, but she's not allowed back there. A lot of times my dad can't go to places, my mom's kicked out of places, just because they were born there. But me and my sister, because we have American passports, we're allowed mostly everywhere. A lot about my culture has to do with my religion. So my religion basically shapes a lot of how we do everything. In my country, there is a mix of Christians, Jews, and Muslims, but the majority is Muslims, so my religion does have a lot to do with how we control our lives. So that's why I brought you guys to a masjid. Have anybody ever been here to a masjid before? Okay.
No.
I'm gonna let the guys go inside the men's masjid to see what it's like. You guys have to take off your shoes, by the way. The most important thing about the masjid is that we have 5 daily prayers, and had we come around 1:10, or you can see the times down there, if it was 5 o'clock, you'd see people from the community gathering here to pray all together and just pray all at once. Like if we came before, you'd capture something better as a sound because there would be somebody who's adhining, like making the call to prayer, so you would hear him say it. So that's what's important about the masjid, is that we pray here. So this is the women's prayer area. As you can see, it's significantly smaller than downstairs. You can watch the imam give his speech. Well, I guess it's a speech. It's called a khutbah.
but I guess it translates into a speech. It's religious, and he talks about current events, and sometimes he just talks about something wrong that may be happening and what and how we can do to fix it. And sometimes there's ladies in the back that can't really see, so we install these TVs so that they can watch the imam upstairs, which is kind of cool.
So when you are born over in Palestine, you're immediately given this card of citizenship. It's a green little foldable card. It almost looks like a passport, but there's no papers in it. And it shows like a mini birth certificate, but it's a picture from like your most recent, you know, traveling thing or whatever. And so both my parents were born over there, so both of them have Hawiyas. But what my dad did when they got married is that he put my mom's name on his Hawiya, because since she's born in Jerusalem, she could have come in from any airport that she wanted to, but since she's on my dad's Hawiya, they recognize her name instantly and they won't let her in. But so that's why they have to go through the Jisid, that's why they have to go through Jordan. Like when we go to Palestine, we don't immediately end up in Palestine. We take a plane to Jordan. From Jordan, we go to the Jordan checkpoint. From the checkpoint, we go to Israel. From Israel to Palestine. And then they let us in the West Bank. And I've been here in Saddam school my whole life. So basically, that's why I say when I come here, I'm like coming home, because I live here.
We believe all dirt and impurity from the world should be taken off before we enter. So we take our shoes off to try and leave all that dirt and impurity of the world behind us. This is the main altar. This god is known as Vishnu. This form of god is known as Vishnu. And all the altars you see around here are different forms of God. There's only one God, and these are all different forms. And this is Lord Krishna. He is known as the most beloved form of God, the most beautiful form of God. And next to him is Radha, Lord Radharani. And we as Hindus are taught to worship one form of God and respect all others, because if we try to worship all forms of God, then our mind gets confused. And that's why we're taught to worship one form and respect all others. So this is the one that I have chosen. This is the form of God that I worship. This place to me, it means a lot. I've been coming here ever since I was a small child, and to me this place is a place where I can come and separate myself from the world, separate myself from whatever problems I may have or whatever I'm going through outside, and I can come in here. This is a pure environment. It's very, very quiet except for the priest reciting all those lines from the scriptures, and those aren't a distraction. They all mean very pure things. So that this is a place where you can just come and sit down right here and just separate yourself from whatever you might be going through in the world.
Probably
I started when I was 7, and I got into it because I knew a lot of girls who danced here and at some other schools, because there's 7 other schools in Milwaukee, so there's quite the variety, I would say. But I loved watching it at Milwaukee Irish Fest. Like, I loved all the sparkly costumes and the fast feet, and it's just so fun to see my friends up there doing that, so I wanted to try. My mom actually won free lessons for me at an auction for another school for like the entire summer. So that's the first time I tried Irish dancing, and then after that summer, I came and signed up for Glencastle, and I've been here since. I've been dancing for almost 10 years now, which is crazy. I can show you my costumes actually over here. We have, this is my school costume. Like I said, on the back of all of them, you're gonna be able to see the Glencastle. We actually just got new capes though, but they still have the new Glencastle on it. They're just whiter and they'll stand out a little bit more. But we wear these for performances, for team costumes at major competitions, and yeah, anytime that we want to show our school spirit, I guess, at any Irish dance event. And then also, I'm also a competitive dancer, so I show that Irish culture, I guess, by traveling the country so far, and hopefully the world soon. I've gone as far as Montreal, Canada, for the world championships and then for the national championships, but I also compete at like regional competitions and local competitions here, like at the Pettit just next door. And we have a lot of other competitions kind of throughout Chicago and the Milwaukee area. But this is a costume that dancers earn through competing, and you have to place first place in a certain level to be able to get the costume. It's a really big deal when you're younger. My family is from Ireland. My family, I have a really big Irish family, especially the ones here in Milwaukee. I have over like 40 cousins, which is crazy. But they're all from, I think I'm fourth generation Irish, and it was mainly my great-great-grandparents that came. They went between Milwaukee and Boston, and finally ended up in Milwaukee and married like a German family, so I'm mostly Irish and German. But the Irish part of my family, like, we love celebrating St. Patrick's Day, of course. We have a big corned beef and cabbage meal at my Nana's house every year. And we also love celebrating our culture by going to Milwaukee Irish Fest, taking part in the parade. My school has a big deal out of the parade that we make, and our shows at Irish Fest are always huge, so that's definitely my favorite part of enjoying that culture. But yeah. Back in Ireland, a very long time ago, dancing was actually banned for a while, which sounds kind of weird, but dancing was banned by the government for a little while. And so people would still want to dance, so what they would do is they'd have like, all of their doors were like the doors that like open halfway, you know what I mean? So they'd have the doors that go to like here, and if they kept their arms down, they thought, oh, it doesn't look like we're dancing, but then they're actually moving their feet, so they were still dancing. So they kept their arms down to hide it from like the soldiers passing by. Yeah.
It's so funny, soldiers don't notice
them
jumping up and down.
Right, apparently not. Not sure how true that is or not, but it's a legend, so. Yeah, alright, who wants to come learn the jig?